We are live via Zoom with Mike Shaw in Minneapolis, Minnesota. Good morning, Mike. Great to have you here on your Photo Vision series.
Royce, it's great to be here. Thanks so much for having me on today.
Glad to have you here. Thank you. You spent 2 years as a postdoctoral research scientist back in Cambridge University in England. Just before your photography career took off, you were a physics and astronomy professor. I don't understand quantum physics, but if we had time here this morning, you could explain that to our complete satisfaction and understanding, right?
I'd be happy to explain quantum physics anytime, Royce. It's best done under a dark sky, however, but anytime.
Oh, well, then we could get multiple enjoyment. Yeah, great. Now, your background and your selfie photo, it kind of reminds me a little of Doc Brown in the first Back to the Future movie with Christopher Lloyd and Michael J. Fox. Although I've never noticed any eccentric characteristics about you, Mike, like in the Doc Brown character, can you explain the premature gray hair that you have on top of your head and your enthusiasm for science and astronomy?
Well, I'd love to be able to explain the gray. I think I prefer to think of it as silver, but I'll go with gray. And no, it's something that started happening, I think, back when I was in my 20s or 30s. It was just one of these things. Don't have an explanation for that. Maybe it's a quantum physics thing. But the enthusiasm for science and astronomy and photography and stuff, it's just been part of our, my upbringing, I guess, and curiosity, and something that I think everyone who's watching this is going to connect with is this curiosity and enjoyment of nature and all the beautiful things that are out there to capture. So it's just what's not to love?
That's a great response. You've written two books. The first, the Complete Guide to Landscape Astrophotography, I think it was, and the most. Oh, there we go. Da da. And your most recent is what? The Composite Nightscapes and Time Lapses, creative nightscapes. Mm-hmm. Those are great books. I highly recommend them. But what impressed me even more is how much time you spend giving back to the community, Mike. Not only do you teach a series of night photography classes, I think it's at Minnesota Landscape Arboretum.
Yep.
But you also organized the annual Aurora Summit Conference, and lately you've been hosting several free online webinars. Are there other things that you're doing that I'm not aware of?
Well, it's a great question, Royce. And, we're all, this whole pandemic, by the way, we're recording this in early July 2020. So this is right in the thick of the C19 event. This has been kind of a transformative time for all of us, everyone watching. But there are a couple of things I thought I'd mention that might be of interest to those watching. And the first is really recently, I've had the honor of being designated a delegate to the International Dark Sky Association, IDA. It's darksky.org. And this is something I think all of us, night photographers or not, are able to learn from in terms of, mitigating our usage of lights and how it affects the environment. And so that's certainly something to look at. There's another thing that, of course, there's the NightScaper Conference, which is something that we sadly missed this year, but certainly look forward to coming back to in 2021. Another thing that's ongoing is I'm running a weekly show on an outfit called SLU.com. And they're a great organization. They are do a lot of public outreach in astronomy. And what they feature are a series of live telescopes in the Canary Islands and in Chile. So you have the Northern Hemisphere and the Southern Hemisphere. And what we do each week is we just, get on. Now it's a Zoom event, of course, because of the, that's everything is by Zoom. and we all just gather around the telescopes. We look through the telescopes. I line up a bunch of missions and talk about the missions, and then connect them in with the Nightscape images. I think that'll do for now. But there's a lot going on.
There is a lot going on in your life, and thanks for giving back to the world in that, and all the public service that you're doing. Let's get personal here for a moment, though, Mike. There are photographers out there who might be thinking, oh, I wish I was a professional photographer so I could devote full time to my art or my hobby. Mike, full disclosure here, you're a family man with two young children and a busy wife who is a medical doctor. A lot of the domestic care falls into your court. How do you balance life?
Thanks for asking that, Royce. Didn't see that one coming. I would say that I don't. I have an attention span of somewhere between 30 seconds and a minute. How do we balance? Well, you know, it's really, my answer to that is I'm just so fortunate to have a family, my wife, an extended family who are very supportive of each other, and we're very all connected, and we all help each other out. I think that's just, I feel very fortunate in that regard. I know that's a very fortunate thing. Two wonderful children. Hey, guys. You know, in terms of making things balance, it's just like everybody else. You do what you can. I mean, it's one of these things that it would be nice to have a grand plan for everything. And as we all know, life just isn't like that. And, you know, being a dad is by far the most, it's just the best. And just, I'll leave it at that. And so it's really just, it's like I'm spoiled for choices. You know, do I do this? Do I do that? But really it's just a matter of, to your question about those aspiring to do this, you just got to do it. You just have to do it, you know? You got to jump in, make the commitment, and just work really hard. I mean, it's just a lot of, you know, it sounds semi-obvious, but it's just a lot of hard work, and you can do it if you put your mind to it, and it's something you really want to do, and you have a vision. And this is a series on your photo vision. So set yourself up with a vision and just don't give up. And, you know, there's that saying, you know, you don't always swing at the home runs. And if I told you the number of failures I've had in my life, it would be much longer than the number of successes. And the other great quote is, I think it was Wayne Gretzky, is like, you want to skate to where the puck's going to be, not where the puck is in hockey. So I don't know if that makes any sense, but I've always liked that quote because you kind of helps you think a couple steps ahead in terms of where things are going. And just work really hard. It's just really a matter of working really hard. And of course, for all of us watching, no sleep. There's no sleep. I was up at 2 o'clock this morning photographing the comet, and you know, what else is new?
Yeah, I went to photograph the comet, and we had a bunch of wildfires come in, and there was brown smoke over everything.
Oh, you know, so it's just, I think also to your point, there's just never a perfect time. You just can't wait until things are lined up, because they're never going to be lined up. You just gotta do it.
Well, I think that you've given some great advice. Just stick in there, keep trying. And I've seen you with your two young children. You're a great dad. Gee, that's the most important thing.
It's indescribable. I'm, you know, just indescribable. So yeah, it's just great.
Well, Mike, we're going to give a link to your website and your social media near the end of this interview. But for now, let's look at a few of your favorite images and talk about them.
Sounds good. Thanks.
Okay, we're here on our discussion with Mike Shaw and some of his slides. And this is pretty obvious that Mike is a great photographer. What an idealistic picture, Mike.
Thank you. You know, I have to say, I should, in full disclosure, this isn't my my picture at all. My wife took this. We were vacationing in Australia a number of years ago now, and this was just setting up for a series of star trails facing north, as it turns out. But
well, that's great.
Yeah.
Well, tell us a little bit about that family history on the left.
Well, in brief, I hope my siblings, I have two brothers and an older sister. I'm number three, so I'm the problem child. I'm the one on the left. So you can see that because my brothers both have socks and shoes on, and I'm just running around barefoot. Nothing really has changed. But we really grew up, my mom and dad and my sister and brothers, we've always kind of had cameras. And I found this image. This was when we were visiting grandparents a few years ago in Wales. So this is in the UK. And we've just always had cameras, always done photography of pretty much everything all through life. So it just seems like a kind of a natural thing.
You were destined to be a photographer.
I had no choice. I wish, I was just, it was pre-programmed.
I wanted to show this slide at the beginning. We've got the alignment of the moon, Mars, and Venus here. You got two different exposures, then an enlargement on the right-hand side. I really wanted to show this to point out that astro-landscape photography is not just about shooting the Milky Way and not just about shooting the core. It's definitely more for you, isn't it, Mike?
Well, absolutely. I mean, this is one of the great things about this, about the whole subject of night photography is just, when we do this, we're really looking into a three-dimensional cosmos, of the universe. And, it's kind of like when you look underwater, you can see these, if you ever look in very clear water, you can see down into the depths. And it's just like this here. I mean, for example, right here, we have the moon, which is, of course, in orbit around the Earth. But in this particular instance, Mars and Venus are actually on the other side of the sun from us, which is why we can see them. And so in this sense, you can imagine that we have the moon, and then below the horizon is the sun. But then on the other side of the sun are these two other planets in the solar system. And I just love that sort of sense of three-dimensionality that images like this convey, along with just so many other things. But yeah, I love this image.
And that's Mount Whitney, the highest peak in continental North America?
Correct.
The United States, I mean.
Yep. Yes.
Now, you took this in 2017 at the full solar eclipse of the sun. Where did you shoot this?
Well, this was such a great project. I did this in collaboration with my colleague and friend Bob Actifreshi, and he was not able to join me on the actual field portion of this, so it was my job to capture the images. And this is the underneath the eclipsed sun, you can see the Grand Teton Mountain. And in the foreground, you can see Lake Solitude. And because of the orientation of this overall alignment, it involved getting out. There's a whole story behind this. I won't go into it now, but it was a very early morning, a very long hike up to altitude, setting everything up under a lot of time pressure. But then what was interesting about this was then the vision was to leave the camera mounted, this is a 14 millimeter lens, leave the camera mounted on the tripod after the eclipse, put the lens cap back on. First of all, shoot the partial phases, as you can see here with a solar filter, shoot the eclipse with the filter off, put the lens cap back on, and then just kind of kill time for about 12 hours until it became dark, and then take the lens cap back off and shoot the stars. So the camera hasn't moved the whole time. And then you blend the star image with the partial phases with the eclipse into this. It's just one of my favorites. It was such a great experience, that whole eclipse. Anyone who's seen it knows what I'm talking about. Just unbelievable.
Well, it's such a fantastic picture. A lot of work gone into this. Some people say, well, how come total solar eclipses are included in nightscapes? Well, if you've been to a total solar eclipse, it's almost like night. I mean, the birds stop singing, the temperature drops 20 degrees.
you can see some of the brighter stars and planets. But in my opinion, I'd put solar eclipses are so phenomenal. I'd put them in with macro photography of flowers. I mean, they're just so incredible. Such an incredible experience.
Nice job. And then, of course, here we have just the corona all by itself, mm-hmm. Blended with the starry night sky.
Yep.
Great. Now you shot this one in the Alabama Hills. This is looking through one of the arches, isn't it?
Correct. Yeah. This is again with Lone Pine Peak is the mountain you see there. Again, Mount Whitney used to live in the area, and one of my favorite places. Mount Whitney is obscured by clouds here. But this was, I had this, this was back in 2012, this image, and this was at the culmination of several years. I think I started around 2009 or so, 2010. And the vision was to capture Orion through the, this is Mobius Arch, familiar to many of us. And you can see the V-shaped Hyades and the constellation Taurus off to the right. You see Canis Major from the constellation Sirius off to the left. Sirius from Canis Major, anyway. But there, the trick to this one is there's a very narrow window of time in early October when Orion is setting in the west. So we're facing west here, and to our back is the slowly rising sun. So this is actually shot during astronomical twilight, early nautical twilight, if I remember correctly. And so you can still see the stars, but the blue in the sky and the faint light on the mountains is from the imminently rising sun. So there's no moon in the sky. This is not a blended shot, just a single exposure. And it's really challenging to get the composition to be just right with everything in focus in a single shot. So it was pretty satisfying when this one worked out.
I love these single exposure shots. No hocus pocus here.
No hocus pocus.
Okay, tell us about this. This is in the Bisi Badlands in New Mexico, isn't it?
Correct. Yeah, it's the Cracked Eggs from a rock formation. Wonderful location. If I just full disclosure, if anyone decides to go there, be sure to take an under a moonless sky. Be sure to take a GPS. You will get lost. Even with the GPS, and at least with the GPS, you'll be able to get back to your car. But make sure, I actually brought two or three. I was doing a workshop there with some students a few years ago and running an all-night time lapse. And then all of a sudden, halfway through the evening, I was talking to one of the students, and all of a sudden it was like a flash went off in her face. And you know, like this, and my back was to this fireball. So I didn't know that it had happened. And I was just so happy when I went through the time lapse sequence later and found that there was a single frame that had captured it. And this particular one left a smoke trail that persisted for just a couple minutes in the air afterwards. So it was really a neat event to be able to see that. So super lucky.
So you were able to see those smoke trails and some of the other time-lapse exposures.
Yes. Yeah.
I made up cool.
It was super neat.
Yeah. That would be a fun sequence to see one of these days.
I'll have a look at it. It's really cool to just, because the smoke trail like forms and then it kind of just wafts away just like a firework, you know?
How cool. Now, this is a star trail. How much time has elapsed here?
Well, this was something on the order, if I remember correctly, only really about, I think around 3 hours, 2 or 3 hours. It wasn't a particularly long time. This is right on, actually nearby the Bisti Donatan Wilderness there, and Chaco Cultural Natural Historical Monument. And this was set up so that this is what you see in the foreground are some ancestral Puebloan structures that are, this particular one is called Pueblo Bonito. It's a huge structure, and many of the architecture was lined up according to the, you know, celestial coordinates. And so these walls here are actually running north-south in the foreground, and I just wanted to line that up with Polaris, the North Celestial Pole here. And what's interesting about this is whenever, you know, I get this, you know, I think we're all asked this question a lot is, well, how do you get these circular star trails? And if you look closely, you'll see that none of the stars make a complete circle, because of course that would be 24 hours and half of that's daylight, so that can't happen. But what happens is there's so many of these stars that they just overlap and they give this illusion of, so this is such a dark location. I mean, it's incredible. This was done under a special permit with a park ranger accompanying our group. I was doing a workshop here. And there's just so many stars that overlap. And they give this illusion of this concentric circles. And it's just a really, really neat thing to see jump out of the computer screen when you're done processing.
It's neat to see modern astronomy and ancient astronomy all mixed in one picture.
Very nice.
Now we've got some aurora pictures here. The one on the left, what do you call that type of aurora that's just overwhelming?
Well, this is looking vertically upwards, and it's called a corona.
Yes.
And, you know, there's about three different types of Corona that we're all familiar with now. The other one's an alcoholic beverage, and the other one, of course, is this terrible virus, but a type of virus. But this is a Corona display, and this was a phenomenal experience. This was back in 2015. And what was funny about this is that normally you think of the aurora happening, you know, dead of winter or the, you know, fall or spring. This happened on the summer solstice. This is the 21st of June, either the 20th or the 21st of June. And it was seen as far south as parts of Georgia. It was just a phenomenally strong display. And, you know, we were looking, I was with my father-in-law. We were out on an excursion in the backcountry. And I just remember looking up and watching this happen. And it felt like I was underneath a glass, you know, kitchen mixing bowl. And I was looking up and someone was just pouring light over it, and the light was just pouring down the sides of the bowl. It was just an incredible experience.
Now on the right, you have an aurora that was in the fall, but you've got another phenomena going on here that I've never seen before. What is that?
Well, that's right, Royce. And if you look carefully, you see the this is an all sky image, a single shot made of an 8mm circular fisheye lens, and it's tilted at about 15 or so degrees so that it can be shown in a planetarium. And what you see here is, of course, the aurora borealis along the horizon, the green and the yellow colors of that. You can also see the Milky Way going across. This was on, I think, the end of August of 2019, August 29th or August 30th. And you can see, the northern Milky Way really off to the right-hand side. But what you also can see is this faint gray curved line. And this is a really interesting phenomenon. It's been given the acronym STEVE, S-T-E-V-E. It's a great story from the Alberta Aurora Chasers group in Canada about how that was named after a cartoon, actually. It was a stimulated thermal, you know, emission of velocity, and there's a bunch of words in there to give it this name. It's actually named after a cartoon.
Now, didn't that Alberta group, weren't they instrumental in not only naming that, but proving that this phenomena actually existed?
Correct. Yeah, no, that's, it's a great story. There's a little documentary that's coming out soon, and they really get a ton of credit because this was a great example of how community science, you know, landscape astrophotographers were seeing this phenomenon and describing it. And there was no, you know, relatively recently, this was not a recognized phenomenon within the aurora community. People thought it was a type of a type of aurora, and it really isn't. And so the latest explanation is that it seems to be some sort of a plasma that gives off this purplish light from the nitrogen molecules in the atmosphere. But right now there's an effort underway to match up satellite observations of these phenomena from space with ground-based observations and photographs like these of the STEVE phenomena. So if any of you listening have any aurora photographs with these types of phenomena, by all means, Google them and see if you can plug them into the community, because they would be most welcome.
It's going to be interesting how this plays out. Now, you've got two pictures here of is this the Perth area?
Well, I call this the Perch because this is it's a kind of a familiar spot to many, but it was just one of those undisclosed locations. And it's just, you're perched over this lake in the High Sierra of California. Like any image that any of us take, there's always a great story behind it. But these two were taken a year or so apart. I think the one on the left was in 2017, if I remember correctly. And the one on the right with Jupiter there is 2018, if I remember correctly.
And a little bit more snow on the left image.
A little bit more snow on the mountains, for sure. Yeah.
But I seem to like the even though there's lack of snow in the right one, the person down at the bottom really adds interest to me. I like the Milky Way better on the left-hand picture, but I like the overall image better on the right-hand because of that person that adds interest and scale. You know,
It's so funny. I completely agree. And the one on the left is actually the enormous panorama. It's four rows of 12 images per row, made with a 24, I think either a 24 or a fast 50 millimeter lens. It's just an enormous panorama and super high detail, not tracked, but just all stitched together. But the one on the right is, I think it's just a vertical panorama. And what happened is the fellow down there who showed up basically just, I heard his voice and I thought I recognized it. So I won't mention his name here, but I called out, "Hey," I acted like I knew he was there. It's like, hey, Royce, what are you doing out here tonight? And he goes, "What? Who's there?" And so I introduced myself again. And so he set up down on the edge of the lake and was just shining his light all over the place. And I was like, "Oh man, you know, get out of my shot." But then I realized afterwards, like, he made the shot. It's like, like you say, I think it adds so much to it. So it's like a lesson that we're going to learn over and over again is, you know, be open to the serendipitousness of visitors.
So true. Okay, I think this is the north window in Arches National Park. Is that correct?
Correct, yep.
And you've got Subaru Seven Sisters right above your head.
Yes.
You're waiting, is this moonlight?
This is moonlight, yes. We're looking, for those familiar with it, we're looking basically east through the, of course, if we see the Hyades and the Pleiades, then that's the direction we're facing as these are rising in the, this shot was in, I think, middle of November of 2018.
Well, this sets us up for this next picture, which is our last one. This is a great story. We'll end with this slide. Tell us about this one, Mike.
Well, thanks, Jan. This was just such an important lesson that follows on with the one I just mentioned. And this was that same shooting experience. And I clearly have a thing with shooting constellations through rock windows. And this is, I don't know what it means, but maybe there's someone out there who could provide me with some insight on this, because I don't know what it is about looking through rock windows, but I have half a dozen of them around my house. And it was only recently I realized there's a theme here. So in any event, I really wanted to shoot Orion through this particular rock window. And it was completely unrelated to the other Mobius Arch example, but it, as you can imagine, required a great deal of planning. I planned this with the Planet Pro app, which is an incredibly powerful app. It allows you to create, you know, virtual representations of what you're going to see. And in any event, this scene was in a fairly narrow window of time, only about 15 or 20 minutes, when the moon that you just saw, brightly shining earlier that evening, you can actually see the bow, you can see Orion's bow just below the top of the arch there. The crescent moon was just about to set here, so we had just a dim amount of light plus the constellation in the arch. And I'm doing this shot, and I flew out, spent all this time prepping it and figuring out exactly where my tripod was going to be and all this stuff. And I was like, okay, it's about to happen. Here comes Orion. And then here comes this couple, and they come up to me and I was like, "Hey, can you take our photo in the arch?" And I'm like, no, I can't. I'm really, and so I was, you know, a little rude. And they were very, you know, I said, okay, it's fine. Don't worry about it. And they just sort of hang out there. And I was like, "Oh, Mike, don't be such a jerk." And so I relented and said, "Okay, go ahead. This is a good time. Go ahead and stand in the arch there and I'll get your," and the moment they stood there, I was like, that's the shot. And
aren't you glad that you had the streak of kindness in your heart?
Well, I don't know if I really did, but it was, or guilt, but in any event, it was a really great lesson. And I've carried that forward as best I can. So this is a great way to end this, is to carry this message forward as we all go into this these uncertain times.
Great shot and very, a great lesson. Okay, here's where people can reach you, Mike, your website. You've got some great guides and gear information, a lot of free stuff in there, but also in your, under your workshops and classes, you've got some neat stuff coming up. You've got some stuff in September and October. some workshops with a National Geographic photographer that you and he worked together. Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, it's a great partnership and friendship, I'll say, with Bob Ektefreshi, who's a National Geographic photographer. He's also, I first learned of Bob Ek many years ago when he founded, and he's the currently the director of the World at Night organization.
TWAN.
Yeah, TWAN, and twannight.org. And it's just, it's such a incredible resource because TWAN really is a collective of probably 30 or 50 or so photographers, night photographers around the world. And the website just has all of these photographs organized by country and by type of night sky phenomenon. But I think most importantly is the mission and the motto, if you will, of TWAN, which is one world, one sky. And it really is about the reality that the night sky is a universal resource for all of us on Earth. You know, whatever country we're living in, wherever in the world we live, it's the same night sky. And I think it's this unifying theme that has always resonated with me. So Bobek and I do a couple workshops each year, one in Southern California, and then we often do the Geminids workshop and others we talked about.
You're doing that in December, the Geminid.
Doing that in this coming December. It's a really favorable year for that. So,
And that'll be in Death Valley?
In Death Valley National Park. Yeah, again, a commercial use permit with the Park Service. And it's a phenomenal location. It's a very dark sky, easy to get to, flying to Las Vegas or to Los Angeles. And
late spring, you're going to do the California Nightscapes with him as well, aren't you?
Correct. Yeah, this year we unfortunately had to reschedule that. We had it set up for this August. And even the September Aurora Summit and the October workshops are a little iffy, but the December one, we're fingers crossed. But 2021, we certainly look forward to the NightScaper Conference with you, Royce, and the rest of the group in Kanab, Utah, and many other things of that ilk. So there's always a lot to look forward to.
You've got a lot going on. Well, here's where you can get a hold of me and my Into the Night blog and my Instagram account. Mike mentioned our NightScaper Conference coming up next May. Mike will be speaking there three times. You'll give three programs, won't you?
Looking forward to it.
Yeah, that'll be great. So this completes another episode in your Photo Vision series. I hope you will subscribe to my channel, Royce Bair. Looking forward to meeting you again. See you later.
Thanks so much, Royce. Take care.
Bye, Mike.
All right.